Less than 3 minutes left in the game, and the Warriors were down by six. Show me on the tape how they managed to pull off this incredible comeback.
Yeah, Greeny, I'm going to jump right into it because there's a lot here, and I think it shows you how much went right for Golden State by their own doing and also some mistakes that were made by Toronto. It starts here now. You're down 3.5 minutes to go, and this is a set that Golden State likes to run where Steph's going to reverse this basketball, and then he starts sprinting. And he's basically going to come all the way to this side of the floor. He's going to get a screen here from Klay. And then Boogie's going to peel out here in a second, and you're trying to get Steph Curry in this area to floor off a double screen. So take a look at what happens. As he comes off this screen, here's where Toronto helps in this situation. Look where the ball is, Andre Iguodala. He's almost at half court, beyond 40 feet for sure. And typically in this series, when Steph Curry has been coming off these screens, he's getting a hard show by the big guy. So there's no passing lane there. And then, of course, you know you're going to get the chase by the defender. But this has been jammed up. And in this case, Marc Gasol should be up here hedging because this pass isn't going to be thrown to Boogie Cousins at the rim from this spot. And he's looking dead at the play. So that's the first mistake Toronto makes. Now, what does Steph do right here? He runs what I call running through the pass. He doesn't stop as he comes off the screen. He literally crosses the screen here. He doesn't catch the basketball till here. And Andre Iguodala puts that thing on a rope. Steph Curry lines it up just behind the line. Why is that important? He had missed four in this quarter that were 25, 28 feet. Another mistake. Here comes Steph Curry. He's probing. He doesn't know where to go with the basketball. He throws it underneath to Andre Iguodala. But watch the overreaction on the part of the Toronto Raptors. Everyone floods to the lane, and you end up with five defenders in the lane around Andre Iguodala. Now, the poise doesn't force this shot. Kick out here to Draymond Green, but what's most important is how quickly Draymond Green gets the ball to Klay Thompson because of how far Kawhi Leonard has to run to close out. No hesitation, ball fake, Kawhi flies by, Klay Thompson steps to the side, knocks down the big shot to give them the lead. So those are the two offensive possessions. Now, let's look at the last defensive possession. Here's where it starts. They elect not to call timeout. Why? I don't think that's a good decision. Because now he ends up catching the ball with 8 seconds left, 40 feet from the basket. If you call timeout, you can dictate where Kawhi catches it closer to the basket and certainly more time on the clock. When you're down by one, you're not holding for the last shot. So that's the first thing. You force him out on the lane. Now, next, look at Iguodala playing center field. Has no regard for his man, Kyle Lowry, leaking out. He's got one job. He's going to shadow Kawhi Leonard wherever he goes with the dribble. He's going to get hit with a blitz. Kawhi takes it right to this area to floor. Klay's obviously chasing him. You're going to get Andre Iguodala meet him right here. I don't have a problem with Kawhi Leonard picking it up. He's in a tough spot right here. Swings it. Here's the last component. Draymond Green fought around to the top side. Why is that important? Because when this ball gets reversed, that means that Draymond Green is closing out on the shooting side of Kyle Lowry on his right hand. Really, really important because as he goes up and you close out on that side, you get this. And the replay showed his fingertip got a piece of that basketball. You deflect it. It goes behind the backboard. I don't think Toronto necessarily managed that situation great right there, but Golden State did everything right down the stretch to go steal a game on the road for the second time in this series. And there's new hope, new life for Golden State headed back to Oracle.
That's really well done, Tim. It's amazing how many little tiny things go into making up these really big things. While I have you, I should ask you, obviously the comeback was enormous and the Warriors' win keeps the series and the season alive, but the entire night really does feel like it was about the Kevin Durant injury. When you saw it, what was your first reaction?
Sick to my stomach. I think the whole time he was playing, I was nervous for him because I think there's a big difference between feeling 100% and being 100%. And I said all along, we would not see him on the court unless he felt normal, which means no tightness back there. And you could even see before the game, I was pointing it out this morning, I didn't notice it at first. The little dance move he made in the tunnel before he came out, the very last thing he did was a scissor kick where his right foot went back and he had full flexion on that joint and on that Achilles tendon. That told me right there, he felt normal. He just hadn't put it through all the rigors you normally would in the course of the regular season. So I was nervous for him, measured himself early. He looked pretty good. The first time he really tried to go instinctively, that happened. So I was sick like everybody else. Clearly his presence had a big impact on Steph and Clay getting off to great starts, and they maintained that throughout the game so they get a win. But now if you're Toronto, you go back to the things that you did to take control of this series. And the one thing you know now, there's no more Kevin Durant looming over this series. You're Nick Nurse, you know now you're proceeding without Kevin Durant. You can focus in on the guy that I think you need to target to try to make less efficient, and that is Steph Curry, because he got loose on them last night, and they were starting to bottle him up and wear him down. I think they get back to that strategy now.
Game 6 Thursday night in Oracle, and if necessary, there'll be a Game 7 Sunday back in Toronto. While I have you here, I just want to give everyone a glimpse into the conversations that take place in our commercial breaks. I had to do a microphone check to make sure Tim Legler could hear me and that I could hear him. And I got DJ here. Now I got two all-time great three-point shooters.
Yes.
So Legler, I'll ask you the question that I asked you during our commercial break. You and DJ, right now, a three-point shootout, who wins?
Well, obviously me. And any shooter worth their salt is going to say the same thing. I'd be disappointed if DJ didn't say himself. You have to stick up for yourself as a shooter.
Oh, of course, I'm winning hands down. You know, Legs is an all-time great shooter. I mean, he's closer to the bottom of the top 50. You know, I'm up there with me, Steph, Clay. He's down there with Reggie and Ray and those guys. So, hey Legs, you know what? It's okay, buddy.
I always understood about you. You're a legend in your own mind, and that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. One thing I know for certain, if Greeny, if you were running a point and you got a three on two fast break, you can't make a bad decision if me and DJ are running the wings.
You're sure right.
The bad decision was letting me run the point in the first place. All right.